Well, good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here again in class. This is so amazing that we are on lesson number 9. Lesson number 9. This is the 9th lesson that we've had to share online. And I'm hoping that all 2 of you that watch this are enjoying the lessons as much as I am working on them all throughout the week for our time together. You know, actually, when I was thinking about putting this lesson together, it is so much easier to put together my lesson, come to church, and get up in front of you and go through the lesson because you're there, we talk, you ask questions, I answer. There is so much interaction. And today, being lesson number 9, I'm still having a hard time getting any interaction out of my cell phone staring at me right now. Are you, see? No reaction. I know that we're not going to be in this quarantine for very long. Come on, it's starting to loosen up. So pretty soon I have a feeling we'll be back together. Maybe not next week, maybe not the next week, but very, very soon. So hang in there. It won't last forever. I will say what we need to do, as we always do in class, we need to open in prayer. If you're worried about something, if you're having issues, if you are in need of prayer because of health reasons, like me, I need some health. I need some health prayer from you guys. The Bible says in Philippians 4:6, don't worry about anything, because worrying is the opposite of faith, and we are to have faith in God. So don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. That's how we communicate with God. And He loves to hear us. Could you imagine if your best friend never spoke to you? We are to pray about everything. So when you wake up in the morning, thank Jesus for getting you up. Thank Him for the day. When you're eating, pray for your food. When you're sitting down to study your Bible, as you should be, you know, pray that He'll open up your heart and your mind and your understanding to know the Word. And when you're watching, binge watching Netflix, maybe the same show for the 3rd time because there's nothing else to watch, pray, Lord, please let this quarantine be over soon. If you've got prayer requests, put them down below. If you're on Facebook, you can put them down below. Sorry, if you're on YouTube, you can't put them down below in the notes. There's no comments. But on Facebook, you can. Put them down there, and Teacher Diana and Miss Haley and Christian, all the people in children's ministry, me included, will pray for you. But as we always do, let's go ahead and put our hands together, close our eyes, and let's open in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank You again for letting us be here. Lesson number 9. I can't believe we've done this 9 times. These poor kids. I'm so sorry for them. And Heavenly Father, we just ask that Your hand will be upon this whole entire time together. Even though it's short, I pray that it will be a great time together as we explore Your Word and learn about You. Help me not to mess up the lesson. Help everybody to understand and be able to use this in our daily lives. And we thank You, Jesus. In Your holy name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, today, as every Sunday, we're going to stand up and we're going to worship. So I want each of you to stand up for worship time. Instead of doing 4 songs, we're only going to do 1. And you all know this song, okay? Now, unless you're in a car, I want you to stand up and I want you to clap along with this song. Because you know this song, you clap along. In fact, you know what? In class, when you guys worship and you guys clap, you guys are way better than your parents. Honest. Because I've been in church. And when Pastor Raymond and the worship team lead a song in the main sanctuary, you know, we start clapping. And then I look around and I go, I'm the only guy clapping still. Everybody else stopped. And your parents are terrible at clapping. So what I want you to do is, I want you to clap along just like you do in class. And I want you to sing loud just like you do in class. And maybe later on, you can help teach your parents how to clap when you're worshiping. Okay? And then when we get back together, I'll look around and see how many of your parents learned the lesson from you guys. Because you guys are awesome. Your parents, not so much. They need some work. Okay, so let's go ahead. You know the song. You also know the whole band, pretty much. Let's go ahead and worship. I invited a few of my friends to help.
Thank you.
right. Well, I hope you guys clapped loudly, and I hope you guys sang loudly. And I hope all your parents in the other rooms are going, what is going on in that room over there? I just hope you're not in a car doing that. So, all right, well, let's go ahead and get our Bibles out, because this is class. This is Sunday school, not children's ministry. This is class. Got to have your Bible. Okay, the Bibles that I set out on the chairs. Hopefully you have your Bible. Now, I'm reading from the English Standard Version, the ESV. Your Bible might have a different couple words than I read, but we'll read along together, okay? We're going to be in Luke today. We're going to be looking at Luke. Okay, we're not going to be looking at that Luke, all right? We're going to be looking at a different Luke, not this Luke. Although, it's, yeah, not that Luke. We're going to be looking at, okay, not this Luke either, okay? We're not going to be looking at this Luke or Yoda. Okay. Speaking of Yoda, I have to mention something, okay? This is not Baby Yoda. Stop calling him Baby Yoda. This is Yoda's baby, okay? And he's 50 years old, so come on, stop calling him a baby. We're going to be looking at the Gospel of Luke in your Bibles. So open up to the Gospel of Luke. It's in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, the third gospel. We're going to be looking at Luke 4, okay? So I want you to go to Luke 4. Now, last week we talked about Jesus, and we talked about, in fact, in the past couple weeks, we talked about Jesus' baptism. We talked about Jesus being tempted. We talked about Jesus calling his disciples, okay? Now we are in Luke 4. Now look down, Luke 4, verse 14. That's where we're going to start. I'll read and you follow along, okay? Luke 4, verse 14, it says, "And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and a report about him went out through all the surrounding country, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day. And he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor.' And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down. And the eyes of all the synagogue were fixed on him." Verse 21. "And he began to say to them, 'Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing.'" Okay, let's stop right there. First of all, if you remember, when Jesus was still not born yet, he was inside his mother Mary's belly. Pregnant Mary, Mary and her husband Joseph, they left Nazareth because they had to go to Bethlehem for the census, for the counting of all the people. You know, we just had a census. We have a census right now in 2020. In fact, I don't know if you've heard about it. I don't know if your parents are talking about it. But right now, our government is doing a census, and we are counting all the people in the United States. Back then, the king had a census. The ruler of Rome had a census, Caesar. And everybody had to go back to the city where they were from. So Joseph gets pregnant Mary, and you know the story. They went to Bethlehem, that long journey to Bethlehem. But now, Jesus is a man. Jesus is about 30 years old. He's a millennial if he was alive today. He's just like the typical, he's not like the typical millennials, but he's that age. Just like Pastor Raymond and all the praise team and a lot of our pastors, like Pastor Josh. Pastor Mike, all those young pastors that we have. Jesus is a man, and it says here he starts his ministry. So he'd been preaching in the region of Galilee. He had been preaching in their synagogues. He had been gathering disciples, and now he comes to Nazareth. Nazareth, his hometown, where he grew up as a child, where he learned carpentry, where he, probably built tables and different things, doors for houses. I don't know if this sign was out there. I don't think it was. When he goes to Nazareth, there wasn't a big sign that says, "Welcome everybody to Nazareth, the hometown of Jesus. Wow, this is where Jesus was born." No, I don't think that was there. There was no parade for him when he came back to Nazareth. There was no big banners, "Welcome home, Jesus. Famous Jesus is back home." It wasn't like that, sadly. So the first thing he does, as is his custom, one of the first things, on the Sabbath, he goes to the synagogue. Now, it wasn't a big, beautiful temple like this. This is in Jerusalem. This is a probably close to what it looked like in Jerusalem. This is a model. It was a much smaller temple, a much smaller synagogue. But he goes and he reads from a scroll. In fact, he's handed the scroll of Isaiah. Now, back then, like we have in our Bibles, it didn't say Book of Isaiah at the top. And it wasn't divided into chapters. And it wasn't divided into verses. So if you look at this big, huge scroll, he rolls it out. It wasn't like he could just go, "I'm going to read today from Isaiah 61. No, that's not what happened. Jesus, the man, was there on the Sabbath in the synagogue, following God's plan. Jesus, fully God, knew exactly what he was about to read. In fact, it doesn't tell in the Bible that he had to look around and say, "Okay, let me see what I can find here to read." No. He opens the scroll and he reads from Isaiah. It might have looked something similar to this, maybe. Although I think Jesus was obviously darker. He'd been out in the sun. He's Middle Eastern. Speaking of out in the sun, I was out in the sun today for like the first time, yesterday for the first time, 2 days ago. Wow, gosh, time flies. I was out in the sun on Friday for the first time in a long time. And I was out there for about maybe 10 minutes, maybe 15, maybe 20. And wow, took a lot out of me. It's probably why I'm so white. Been sitting inside the house, binge watching Netflix and Hulu and Amazon and Disney Plus. way too much binge watching. But I was outside. In fact, this is what I got to witness. I got to witness my grandson, Brennan, and Pastor Raymond goofing around out in the backyard of my house. Okay, I went off on a tangent. Sorry, Isaac. I know you're probably thinking, there he goes again. Back to our story. So Jesus gets up with the scroll of Isaiah and reads these words. Look at Luke 4, 18 to 19 again. Luke 4, 18 to 19. He reads, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who were oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Those words were written by Isaiah in the book of Isaiah about 700 years before Jesus, and it's written about the Messiah. Jesus gets up, reads those words, sits down and says, "This is about me. It's all fulfilled. Here I am." Let's look at Isaiah 61 quickly. You don't have to turn there because we just read the words of Isaiah 61, even though we're in Luke, because it quoted Isaiah 61. Isaiah 61. The book of Isaiah, written about 700 years before Jesus came on the scene. And it says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners." That's a different version than the ESV. Your Bible might even say something a little bit different. But this was talking about Jesus. And Jesus sits down and says, "It's about me." Now, you would imagine everybody would be, "Oh my gosh, yes, praise God, the Messiah is here." Not exactly. Let's get back into Luke. Open up your Bibles back to Luke, where we left off. We left off at Luke chapter 4, and we read 20 and then 21. On verse 21 it says, "And he began to say to them, 'Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing.'" Meaning, here I am, I'm the Messiah. Today, this has happened. I'm here. This is written about me. Here I am. Now let's continue reading. Verse 22. "And all spoke well of him and marveled at the gracious words that were coming from his mouth. And they said," wait a minute, hold on. Back up. "Is not this Joseph's son? We know this guy." Let's keep reading. Verse 23. "And he said to them," doubtless you will quote me this proverb, "Physician, heal yourself. What we have heard you did at Capernaum, do here in your hometown as well." They were saying, "We saw you. We've heard about all the miracles you did in Capernaum, and do a miracle here. Let's see. Let's see some proof you're Messiah." And verse 24, he says, "Truly I say to you, no prophet is acceptable in his hometown." That's why they didn't have that big sign saying, "Welcome Jesus." Verse 25, "But in truth I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heavens were shut up 3 years and 6 months, and a great famine came over all the earth," all over the land it says. "And Elijah was sent to none of them, but only to Zarephath in the land of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow." Not one of their people. Verse 27, and he says, "And there were many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian." All those Jewish people that were lepers were not healed, but God healed Naaman the Syrian. "So when they heard these things, all in the synagogue were filled with wrath, and they rose up and drove him out of the town and brought him to the brow of the hill, a cliff, on which their town was built, so that they could throw him down the cliff." They were that angry. Verse 30, "But passing through their midst, he went away." What? So here they are angry with him for what he said. Not very happy. In fact, the religious leaders were often angry with Jesus because Jesus spoke the truth and the religious leaders were hypocrites. They preached one thing and they lived their life another way. Our story point today. Our story point for the lesson is Jesus taught that he is the Messiah. Jesus himself said, "Today this is fulfilled. I am the Messiah." This was his teaching throughout his ministry. Our big picture question: what makes people special? Why are you special? Me? I'm not special. What makes us special? Let me rephrase that. What makes us special to God? We are special because we, you, me, male, female, boy, girl, we are made in God's image. And not only are we made in God's image, we are made to know him, to worship him. We are special to God because of that. Look in Psalm 100, verse 3. You don't have to look there now. Just read along with me on the screen. Psalm 100, verse 3 says, "Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. And he's our shepherd, our loving shepherd, that protects us from all the wolves out there that want to devour us. Our key passage today is one you all know. It's John 3:16. You can open your Bibles to John 3:16. John 3:16 tells us a very, very important message, and everybody should have this memorized. Everybody should know this because it sums up a very important message for all of us. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." John 3:16 tells us about what happened on the cross. John 3:16 tells us that God loved us so much that he sent his only Son, Jesus, his blameless Son, his innocent Son, his Son that had never done anything wrong, had never sinned. He sent his only Son to die a painful, agonizing death on the cross, to pay the penalty for all of our sins, for your sins, for my sins, to take that penalty so that whoever believes in Jesus shall not die and be separated from God forever in hell. No. Because we all know that God did not design hell for us. God wants all of us with him in heaven. So if we believe in him, we shall not die and be separated from God forever. No. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, shall not be separated. Whoever believes in him will have eternal life with God in that place prepared for us called heaven. John 3:16 tells us how much God loves us. John 3:16 tells us that God loves you. Don't ever forget that. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus taught that he was the Messiah. Jesus taught that he was our Savior, and he went willingly to the cross to take our penalty, to die on the cross, so that we could be with him forever. That's how much God loves us. That's how much God loves you. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? Oh, I can't wait to be back together so I can hear that in person. Don't forget that God loves you so much. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this message. Thank you for coming on the earth and teaching for all of us that you are the Messiah, the Savior, the Christ Jesus. Thank you for dying on the cross and taking the penalty for our sins. And thank you for providing a way for each and every one of us to go to heaven by believing in you. Heavenly Father, we just pray that this quarantine will be over quickly. I pray that those that are watching this right now, if they have any needs, that you would comfort them, that you would heal them, that you would put your loving arms around them and just hold them and let them feel how much you love them. Because as your word says, you do love us. Heavenly Father, just please, again, have your hand upon our families. Have your hand upon each and every one of us. Keep us safe until we're back together again next week to hear your word. And again, Lord, let it be in person soon. We thank you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. In your holy name we pray. Amen. All right, so I want to let you all know before I say goodbye, usually I have like a little funny thing at the beginning and a little funny thing at the end, you know, like a couple seconds after the lesson's over. You don't have to watch to the end because there's nothing at the end funny. If you notice, there was nothing at the beginning that was funny. You're probably thinking, you've never seen anything in my videos that was funny. Okay, whatever. But so I just want to let you know that, again, please keep me in prayer because, as I've shared before, I've been having some nerve damage issues in my legs and my back, and it's excruciatingly painful at times. And so it's making it hard to kind of get things done, including the lesson. So keep me in prayer. And again, put down below that any prayer requests you have. And you don't have to watch to the end because there's nothing funny after the lesson, okay? So I love you guys. Hope to see you soon. And until then, keep reading your Bible. Keep studying the Word. Keep praying to God. And don't give up hope. Pray about everything. And I'll see you soon. Love you. No, seriously, I told you there was nothing funny at the end. So why are you even watching this? There's nothing funny going on right now, okay? No, I'm serious, nothing. I'm not doing anything funny. You can just stop watching. Why are you still watching? There's nothing funny, okay? I'm done, I'm leaving, okay? Oh!